Hello, today we will be discussing about radiotherapy. I am Dr. Saurabha Kumar, consultant radiation oncologist. With me is Dr. Heba Altaf and Dr. Jayant, both consultants at the Department of Radiation Oncology, Majumdar Shaw Cancer Center, a unit of Narayana Health City. Today we would like to discuss some of the myths and concepts about radiation, and also a lot of questions which are being asked by patients. So we'll try, and as a consultant we will discuss about the things and which will kind of give an idea for the patients. So Dr. Heba, what is basically radiotherapy, and how do we explain it to the patients?
So whenever the patients come to us, the first question always is, what is radiotherapy? Because most of the people have no idea what it exactly is. So to explain to a patient in a layman's term, it is nothing, it is just x-rays. The x-rays that we are using in the x-rays, CT scans, these are the same x-rays, but they are high energy x-rays. So we use low energy x-rays for diagnostic modalities, but we are using high energy x-rays for the treatment of cancer. Then there are some other types of radiations also, electron and proton, but the main idea behind that is to treat the cancer. So these radiation that we are using, how they act, how are they treating cancer when we are giving? So main thing that they do is they target the DNA of the cancer cell, and that is how they are acting. So main idea behind radiation therapy is to give maximum radiation to the cancer, to the tumor cells, and try to save all our normal structures that are surrounding it. So we have to explain to these patients regarding this radiation that it is safe. And we will talk about all the side effects and everything that comes with it.
So you mean to say there is no current or there is no burning, which is the usual concept?
Yeah, most of the patients refer to them as light, like current, whether we will have any burning sensation when we are giving the same radiation. It is exactly like taking a CT or X-ray. You don't feel anything. We don't prick, or you don't, when you are receiving radiation, you don't feel any burning sensation. Oh, I am having something is going through me. You won't feel a thing. Once your treatment is done, you won't feel anything. It is just that you have to lie on a couch, and we will explain what is the process of radiation, but that is it.
So Jayant, just wanted to know, so how different is it from chemotherapy? Majority of the patient, they get confused whether what is chemotherapy and what is radiation. How do we differentiate it, and are the side effects different? So how do you would say, like, explain to the patient? Because when we, after the, like, majority of the time when they come to us, there is a lot of confusion about chemotherapy and radiotherapy.
So so presently in the domain of cancer treatment, there are basically four or three modalities. One is surgery, one is chemotherapy, the third one is radiotherapy. A newer one that's coming up is immunotherapy. So basically, surgery and radiation, in the broad sense, these are both considered as local treatments. So chemotherapy is called systemic. So basically, chemotherapy is slightly different. It is either in tablet form, or it's given in some injectable form. It is mixed with some sort of fluid, and it is infused in the blood. So chemotherapy circulates throughout the blood, and it targets cancer cells wherever they are in the bloodstream or elsewhere. But radiation is considered a local treatment. So wherever there is disease, either seen at the time of clinical examination, or disease that is seen on the imaging, it could be a CT scan, it could be an MRI scan, or it could be something like a PET scan. So wherever there is disease, or wherever there is a risk of disease being there before surgery, after surgery, these areas are targeted using radiation. So the side effect profile again is very different. Chemotherapy, because it's basically systemic, it goes throughout the body, the side effect profile is slightly different. Radiation, the side effects associated with radiation are more local. So if you're treating the head and neck region, if you're treating the neck, we're treating the throat, the side effects that the patient will experience is limited to that region alone. Similarly, when we're treating the pelvis, when we're treating the abdomen region, it's very unlikely that they will have side effects either above that or below that. So it's limited to that area of treatment.
Just continuing, just one more question just propped up. So a lot of patients keep asking that, you know, after I take radiotherapy, is there a risk or hazard to anybody else? I think they just take home the message from PET scan where they are probably told to, you know, just stay away from the family for an hour or so. So is there anything like that from a radiation point of view?
From the radiation point of view, it's absolutely safe. There is no risk of radiation being, you know, transferred on to the family members, or so it's absolutely safe. Even before the door is open and someone comes inside, there is absolutely no radiation in the patient's body. The patient is not really emitting any radiation from his body. It's absolutely safe, and it's actually advisable to stay with some family members, kids being in the same room, pregnant women being in the same room as the patient is absolutely safe. There are no issues at all.
So Hiba, what are the common sites which we usually treat?
So radiation as a part of cancer treatment can be, with the intent of treatment, can be different for different sites. So in some cases, you can radiation can be the only definitive treatment that a patient needs. So there are certain sites like early stage has some head and neck tumors or some prostate tumors where you can completely treat the patient with radiation alone. But then there are some other tumors where you have to give it combination with other modalities. Like in some cases, we have to give radiation with chemotherapy. So there are certain sites like cervix, like head and neck, advanced head and neck tumors. So in those cases, you need to give radiation, but you have to give concurrently some chemotherapy also. Then the third thing comes with surgery. Now there are other sites where we have to give radiation either post-surgery or in some cases before surgery. So there are cases like oral cavity tumors, there are cases like breast cancers. Now in those cases, patient needs to go for surgery first, but post-surgery they may require radiation. And then we have other cases like in palliative cases where the patient already has advanced disease, but you give radiation just for symptom control. Sometimes they may have bone mets which is causing severe bone pain. They may have a big mass which may be compressing some nerve and causing symptoms. So in those cases, you just give radiation for symptom. But as long as a definitive or a curative intent, there are lots of sites where radiation is a part of modality. Like I said, like breast, we have lungs, we have head and neck tumors, we have all the pelvic tumors. Like we have rectal tumors where we give radiation before surgery. Where there the concept, idea is to reduce the size of the tumor so that afterwards the surgery becomes much more feasible.
So Jayat, it might be an overlap with a lot of things. So is always radiotherapy given before surgery, like it is always given after surgery? So there is a concept that, you know, it is always an adjuvant treatment. So what is adjuvant or neoadjuvant? Something what Hiba was trying to tell. So can you give a little bit more idea?
So just continuing with what Dr. Hiba said. So radiation about 50 to about 65% of all cancer patients will require radiation at some point in their treatment. So if it's very early disease some tumors are known to be very sensitive to radiation, so the radiation could be the sole modality. But in slightly advanced malignancies, surgery will be offered upfront. So surgery will be the first offered treatment after surgery to kind of address the microscopic cancer cells that may be there in the vicinity of the tumor. So once the cancer is removed, we assume that there may be a few cancer cells left behind either in the tumor bed or in the neck or wherever. So just to mop up these cancer cells that may be left behind, radiation could be offered as an adjuvant modality. So this is fairly commonly offered in head and neck cancers, in breast cancers, sometimes in other sites after surgery when we realize that there are quite a few risk factors. Based on the pathology report, we may offer radiation as an adjuvant modality. In a few other sites, just to facilitate a better surgery, just to reduce the size of the tumor so that surgery becomes easier. And also they have found that offering radiation upfront has translated into better survival in a few sites. So sites like the esophagus, the food pipe, the rectum, we can offer adjuvant, we can offer radiotherapy prior to the main modality. So that becomes neoadjuvant radiotherapy, and that will be followed by some sort of definitive treatment like surgery or whatever.
And what about, is it always radiotherapy, is it that radiotherapy is always given for cancer only? Don't we treat a lot of benign tumors as well? So,
yeah. So, radiation started off initially being used for cancers. Very early on, they also tried using radiotherapy for a lot of other diseases. Some of the benign conditions like schwannomas, a whole lot of meningiomas, a whole lot of functional disorders. So that has been used since about 100 years now. It's a very established treatment modality for a number of benign lesions as well. It's not necessarily always for cancer.
Yeah, as simple as even keloids. The keloids also, it is being underutilized. But post-surgery, if there is a keloid and you repeatedly keep doing surgery, it will come back. So we need to do some form of radiation to stop that cycle. So what about the complications? Is it always hair loss? Like women are always worried about hair loss. And then there is a lot of, I think there is a lot of confusion because there will be overlapping toxicities like vomiting and all those things. So how do we explain to patients? You know, even a breast cancer patient is worried about hair loss when we are giving radiation. So what is your take and how do we explain to the patient?
So what happens is when any patient that comes to us, they might have already spoken to somebody who has undergone radiation therapy, and they think whatever symptoms that patient had, they will also have the same side effects. And some patient may have undergone chemotherapy and they think those side effects will happen. So what happens with radiation is, it, as Dr. Jayan said, that it is a local treatment. So your side effects also are based on the site that we are treating. So in case of, like, we are treating a breast cancer, so in those cases the side effects will be limited to the area that we are treating. So in those cases the patient may have skin reactions, maybe some redness later on, maybe some darkening of skin, and some portion of maybe lung and heart can receive a little bit of radiation, but that will be a late side effect. It can happen. But if we consider that whether side effects like hair loss will happen in a patient of breast cancer, that usually doesn't happen because we are not giving radiation in this region. We are giving radiation in a completely different region. So patient with a breast cancer will never have side effects of pelvic region, will never have side effects of head and neck, will never have side effects of loss of hair or difficulty in swallowing. Now similarly, if a patient of head and neck cancer, he is undergoing radiation, so they will have side effects related to those organs. They may have some swallowing difficulty, they may have some ulceration in the mouth, they may have difficulty in pain while swallowing. So again, skin reactions is a common thing with radiation, and that is also mostly limited to redness or blackening of skin. And once the radiation stops, these all side effects usually subside in 3 to 4 weeks. Then we have also like pelvic cases. Pelvic cases will have a completely different toxicity profile. They will again have some side effects related to bladder. They may develop burning sensation in urine, maybe they may have frequency of urine, they may develop abdominal pain or loose motions. So they are completely different from the patient who is receiving radiation for head and neck or breast. So we have to, before the patient comes for the treatment or whenever you go for meet a doctor, you have to discuss completely what kind of side effects are expected. It is not like one, their relative or someone they know has developed certain side effects and they will also develop same side effects. So you have to explain in detail what side we are treating, what side effects will be expected, and how long they can have those side effects and they will subside over a period of time.
Thank you, Hiba. So Jayant, whenever the patient comes and we start planning for the treatment, so there are different technology being used like 3D CRT, IMRT or VMAT. And how do we explain to the patient what exactly these are and what is the advantage you offer by going into a newer technology or whatever is the best today? So what do you, how do you explain to the patient? So what message do we give to the patient as to what, how they choose between the modality?
So like I earlier said, so radiation's been in practice for about 120 years now. Very early on, radiation, it was fairly crude. The equipment was very outdated. So basically, radiation, the using the conventional techniques, the we would just give half the radiation from the right, half the radiation from the left. So inevitably, the complications would end up being fairly severe. But we've come a long way since then. With the advent of 3D CRT, which is three-dimensional conformal radiotherapy, we were able to use CT scans to mark out the tumor. We were also able to make sure that the radiation ends up going into a shaped field. It takes the shape of the tumor, unnecessarily giving radiation to large areas of the face or to the pelvis or to the abdomen. That could be avoided using 3D CRT. From then, we've moved on to IMRT, intensity modulated radiotherapy. So that again has been used, has been in use since the late 90s. So for this, we have used again three-dimensional imaging, 3D CT scans. We have also used imaging from other modalities. So we are able to mark out the tumor in great detail. Also, what we do is we basically split up the beam into different parts, and each part within that beam can be planned to offer a different intensity of radiation. So we modulate the intensity within that beam. So the area that we're treating exactly will take the shape of the tumor with a small margin. So unnecessary radiation to the surrounding organs is greatly reduced when we offer IMRT. So when we're treating the head and neck, I can just treat the tongue or I can just treat the cheek, and it can completely protect some of the normal organs that are right next to it using advanced techniques like IMRT. Then there was also a technique called the IGRT, image guided radiotherapy. So in order to make sure that we are delivering the right dose to the right area, we need imaging either prior to starting treatment or imaging during treatment. So this sort of image guidance that we use in order to make sure that IMRT is being delivered well, that constitutes image guided radiotherapy. We've slowly moved on to something called VMAT, which is volumetric modulated arc therapy. So this is a very advanced sort of IMRT, wherein the machine, the head of the machine, will continuously rotate around the patient, you know, in a sort of an arc, in a 360 degree manner. The radiation will continuously be emitted from the treatment head, while making sure that the high dose of radiation exactly hits the tumor and all the surrounding critical organs which are right next to it are protected to a significant extent. So we might be treating very tricky areas in the brain or very close to the eyes, close to the ears and things, close to the spinal cord. We can give a very high dose, very conformal, accurate delivery of a good dose to the tumor while completely protecting the important organs like the spinal cord and the parotid glands. We also come on to stereotactic.
So what is, just before stereotactic, I just want to know what is the technology you use for tracking any kind of moving organ? So like if you are treating something in the lung, or if you are treating to avoid the heart in a breast cancer. So what do you do there?
Yeah. So there are a couple of things. One is we can, so we have something called active breathing control or respiratory motion management. So we can use this. Basically, we know where exactly the tumor is during the course of you know, the patient's breathing cycle. So when the patient takes in a deep breath, we know exactly where the tumor is. When the patient takes a deep breath out, We know exactly where the tumor is. So using this information, we can track the tumor in real time, and we're able to exactly deliver a good dose in that part of the respiratory cycle. So the moment we know that the tumor has moved away from our intended area, we can automatically stop the radiation. So that would translate into lesser side effects to the lungs, lesser side effects to the heart, while making sure that the high dose hits the tumor alone and nothing else.
Iba, what is this newer things like SBRT and then stereotactic radiosurgery?
So now the newer techniques that are coming, they have been now for a decade or more. So we have like stereotactic radiosurgery, which is short form is SRS, or we have stereotactic radiotherapy or stereotactic body radiation. So these all have stereotactic. Stereotactic means we are giving the radiation only to the tumor. It has to be very concise. It has to be very conformal to the tumor only. And in these cases, what we are giving is the normal, normal cases, we give radiation usually in small doses every single day. So your treatment duration may last from maybe 2 to 3 weeks to almost 6 to 7 weeks, like in head and neck cancers. But in stereotactic, we are giving a very high dose to a small tumor, and it is very conformal. That is, just outside the tumor, the dose will be very, very less. So the surrounding structures of the tumor will receive very less dose, and the side effect related to that will be very less. And since you are giving very high dose to the tumor, your chance of cure are more. But the issue with this is that it cannot be used in all types of tumors. You can't use SRS or SRT in breast cancer or a big tumor like in a head and neck tumor or rectal tumor. So you have to have a certain indications where we will be using this. Like SRS, we mostly are using in small brain tumors like meningioma, even some benign conditions like Dr. Saurabh was talking about, like non-cancerous conditions like meningioma, schwannomas, even AVMs. So these kinds of things can be treated just by SRS. You can just give the high dose of radiation to that spot and you can get a very good cure rate. Now apart from that, for SRS, we need a specific size of a tumor. It can't be very big, very huge tumor. Now if the tumor is slightly bigger than what is intended for SRS, then you can go for SRT, where you give a little bit higher dose, but in maybe 3 sittings or 4 sittings. It's again the same idea is applied, that it is stereotactic, it is very conformal, but you may not give in a single sitting, you will give it at least 3 to 5 settings. Now the third one is SBRT. SBRT is stereotactic body radiation, which we are giving any part of the body. So the most common sites where we are giving we are giving in prostate, we are giving in some bone mets, if limited bone mets. We are giving in lung metastasis or primary lung. So these are very like early stage lung cases which are not amenable for surgery. They have so many comorbidities, they can't be taken for surgery. But they still have a good chance of cure rate if they go for SBRT lung. Similarly, previously in prostate, we were giving radiation for almost 7 to 8 weeks. But now the trend is changing. You can use this technology like SBRT to treat early or intermediate risk prostate cancers and have a good cure rate.
Yeah, thank you, Hiba. So I think we have covered more or less everything. What about the complications or the side effects? I think that also we have covered. So we are coming to the end of this session, and thank you, Hiba. Thank you, Jayant, for giving us this full insight about radiotherapy. So basically, the whole idea is that radiation is very much an integral part of oncology treatment. Close to 70% of cancer treatment patients will be at some point coming to the radiation department. There is nothing to be worried. The technology has advanced over the years, and it is really very precise, and the toxicity is very much local compared to chemotherapy, where the systemic toxicity will be there. So please don't get confused with different people having taken different forms of radiation. So currently the technology is much different, and also there are a lot of other indications or benign case indications also for radiotherapy. So many a times people get worried that when the patient comes for radiation, it is always cancer. No, that's just a myth. So this is what we want to kind of give the information to the public. Thank you.